Bruce DuMont back in Chicago. We've got Mike Miller from DePaul University with us this evening. We've got Kristen McQueary. She's on the editorial board of the Chicago Tribune. We have Peter Hanna from Chicago Kent College of Law, also with the ACLU. And we have Georgia Logothetis, who's a contributing editor of the Daily Kos. Professor, as the economist, let's look at the February jobs reports came out. 20,000 jobs, which is a lot less than was expected. Give us your assessment of this report.
Never put any faith into how many were expected. That's simply a guess. That's a forecast. That's a useless number. All that matters is the number that comes out. And you should never look at such numbers one at a time and draw many inferences. What you want to look at is the average over time, or if there's any kind of a trend going on there. And the numbers are still astounding. This will be... In July, it will be the longest expansion in the history of the American economy. It'll be 10 years old, and the moment it gets past July, it will be the longest on record. Unemployment, one of the things people are beginning to talk, the word recession has been brought up. Recessions are, in almost every single case, preceded by a rise in the unemployment rate of about a half a percent or more before the recession kicks in. There's no evidence that that is occurring. There's also a thing called an inversion of a yield curve, which has not occurred. So the economy, when they take, there's a manufacturing index. They ask manufacturers, how much are you doing? How do you look towards the future and so forth? Instead of falling, it has risen in the most recent thing. So almost across the board, with the exception of housing, which is a little bit weak now that interest rates are a bit higher, the economy is just fine. Interest rates seem to be just where they, I'm hoping the Fed will leave them alone.
There was an increase in wages, 3.4% increase in wages. How was that determined?
That's done through a survey. There's something called the Current Population Survey, and the Bureau of Labor Statistics simply piggybacks on that monthly survey. They call 60,000 households a month, and they ask them a whole series of questions, and that's where we get the unemployment rate and the wages and work week and all those different types of things. And we also get data from a survey of what are called establishments, companies. 400,000 every month are surveyed to ask them how many jobs do you have that are filled in your establishment.
Is there a way to determine when you're looking at the increases in wages? Is there any way to determine whether or not someone who's, let's say, making $35,000 or $40,000 mm-hmm. a year, compared to someone that's making $80,000 or $90,000 mm-hmm. a year? Whose wages are going up?
Well, ultimately, those data will come out later when we have all the tax returns data. That's why it takes several years for us to get really good data on income distribution, because you have to wait till the tax returns data come back in. But many of these numbers are for manufacturing employment, for example. So these are people that are on the main line doing the manufacturing work, and how many dollars are you being paid by hour? And not everybody gets a raise at exactly the same time. So every given month, different people will be getting raises, and those simply accumulate over time. And workers are finally, after many years where workers were not getting their cut, workers are getting their cut.
Some of the new left in the Democratic Party, they would like to make 2020 a referendum on either socialism or capitalism. Sure. As an economist, and as someone you'd like to see a mm-hmm. conservative be elected president, mm-hmm. Even though you were not a supporter of Donald Trump, would it be good to have a whole campaign that really looks at the free enterprise system and capitalism versus socialism? Or are you worried that your side might lose that race?
I don't think we will lose. My problem I usually have it is that it's almost always a comparison between the promises of socialism, of what it could be, not what it is in Venezuela or Cuba, what it could be versus what capitalism actually is. And capitalism has warts, there's no doubt about it. But socialism is inherently flawed. It does not accept human that we are self-interested, and it doesn't tap into that self-interest. And because it is going to discount the importance of self-interest and so forth, it will not lead to the largest possible outcome.
Georgia Logothetis, let me ask you the same question. You're left of center. You've been a progressive for
I don't think there's – I mean, the right is going to try and make it a debate between socialism and capitalism, but that's not a debate that's actually happening in the Democratic Party. We throw around labels a lot, right? What's socialism? It's advocating that the government owns the means of production. Nobody on the left is seriously advocating that. Even if you look at AOC, right, who they put on posters as a socialist, what is she really advocating? She's not saying the government's going to come and seize the means of production.
And she doesn't know what socialism is.
She's saying policies that are actually supported in polls by the vast majority of the American people. What we are seeing, and by the way, I think it was Warren had a great response to a similar question. She says, I'm a democratic capitalist. I want capitalism to work, and it doesn't work when people cheat the system, which is what's happening now. Going back to the wage growth issue, because I think that ties into what we're talking about in terms of socialism versus capitalism. It's great that we're seeing the unemployment numbers where they are. What happens when we reach full employment? That's
there.
One question.
We're
almost there, right?
We're
if
there.
Not, we're there. Yes, I'll defer to the expert economist on that one. And then we need to start talking about real wage growth. And it's great that we've had this uptick in wages, but it's certainly not enough to make up for the fact that the vast majority of wealth that has been created over the last 10 to 20 years has gone to the upper 1%. And I think in the Democratic Party, when you talk about policies like making sure that people get a fair wage for a fair day's worth of work, you're going to hear cries of socialism from the right, but they're really talking, again, about policies that are supported by the majority of American people.
But remember, the second half of socialism is not just the public mean, the public ownership of the means of production. It is also where the government makes decisions on the pricing and the distribution of the goods that are produced, including the price of labor or the price of energy or the price of medicine and so forth. Socialism is inherently flawed because it doesn't go through the calculating process that a market does to find the right price to allocate the scarce resource.
I'm going to ask a campaign-related question. Because AOC is such an articulate spokesperson, she is a media darling. She's pushing this message. She's getting all kinds of feedback and a tremendous couple of million people on Twitter. If she defines the race, isn't it going to be easy for the Republicans and President Trump to refer to her and the Democratic Party as a socialist party? Because he knows how to brand, Peter.
Sure he does.
I mean, I think it becomes easier for her to be a target, but the truth is, actually what both of you have said, particularly Georgia, I mean, there are these issues that an overwhelming majority of the electorate are pretty clear on. You know, everyone should have health care for all. Taxes should be higher on the super ultra wealthy. There should be more social services, you know, better education and more abundant education for people at all wage levels. And I think really what she's going to have to do and what the candidates are going to have to do is bring it back away from the name calling and away from a lot of the kind of targeting and say, like, look, we're not campaigning as socialists to rebuild, you know, the economic system around a like socialist kind of foundation. But we're saying that Americans want this, and Americans need this, and it's 2020.
Do you agree with that, Krista?
I mean, I don't know what everyone's individual definition is of socialism, or even what the actual definition is. I just see, especially in this state, you have socialist policies, the huge expansion of government, and continuing to do so. We spend billions of dollars on anti-poverty programs, and they're not working. Our spending on education in this state alone has tripled over the past 10 years. Where is all the money going? I mean, it's this idea that somehow the opportunities aren't there or we're not supporting social services. Our taxes have been increasing. We were talking a little bit about Illinois exodus and people just kind of giving up. So to me, that's kind of what the beginning of socialism looks like. You had a socialist party commenting on Governor Pritzker winning the election and some of these other lawmakers who are now in Springfield talking about rent control and things that are socialist policies.
We got to be back shortly from Chicago. Bruce DuMont back in Chicago. Thanks for joining us. I want to pick up on our conversation about the Democratic field for 2020. And Bernie Sanders is out there. He's raised a lot of money. He's still playing to big, big crowds. Are you worried about his age, Georgia?
I'm worried about everybody's age. Being a president is a very stressful job. If you mean like from an electability standpoint, I think he's got his base. And it's actually grown in the last year. His email list has grown. His fundraising has grown. I think that people are willing to sidestep the age question with him. Now, will they do the same thing with Biden? Will they do the same thing with anybody else that's older that gets in the race? I don't know. But Bernie has this energy, especially because of the way he describes his policies, that is kind of making people forgive his age a little bit.
If Biden chooses not to run, and that's still a possibility, or if he gets into the race and he sputters and he does not appear to have the muscle that people hope he has, who emerges as the centrist? Is it Amy Klobuchar or is it someone else, Peter?
I think Amy Klobuchar is probably the person who takes up the mantle of the centrist in the Democratic among the Democratic candidates. I think actually you shouldn't overlook Kamala Harris, who I think will at that point probably really emphasize her prosecutorial career, tough on crime, and you know her bona fides there. But it's really hard to say. I think just to respond to your first question, I think Bernie's age is probably irrelevant for the folks that are in his base. It's probably irrelevant for most people, particularly given that the current sitting president is right around the same age. But yeah, I do think with Biden gone, it's probably going to be Amy Klobuchar and a couple of others who will kind of move around that central role.
She could emerge, obviously, as a vice presidential candidate. One other question I want to ask of everybody is that, Bernie Sanders in the past has never been able to really generate a lot of excitement in the African-American community. And now you have Kamala Harris, you've got Cory Booker running. What is he going to do? A couple of weeks ago, we had Don Rose, who's one of the legendary strategists in local politics here, also does a lot of national stuff. And he just said that he didn't think that Bernie Sanders learned anything from 2016 on how to really reach out to black folks and feel their pain and feel their suffering. Does anybody disagree with that?
No,
point?
I don't. Mm-hmm. I don't, Chris. And
but
Rose,
how do you win
a
Democratic
insightful
primary without it? How do you win a general election? How do you win a general election without an enthusiastic black base? I don't know how you do it.
I mean, the black vote is very.
You pick an African American VP. That's what you do.
Well, VP is, or is VP going to be enough?
I mean, I was going to say the as a electorate or a voting block, the black vote is very reliable when it comes to actually getting out and voting. So I think if Bernie is a Democratic candidate, he will get the black vote. But you're
he's
right.
He's not going to get a. He's not. He'll have the same problem that Hillary did. Hillary should have had a much stronger black turnout, but she didn't have it because she wasn't black. So the question is, if you want to win an election, does your candidate have to be black?
I don't think so at all.
I don't think so. I don't think
so.
Does
it have to be a woman?
I don't think so at all.
I think they have to be authentic, and I think that we've talked about that a little bit earlier, where Bernie probably does have more of an authenticity vibe than Hillary Clinton. But you're right. I'm not. There's no like feel the burn signs in Chicago Southside neighborhoods that I've seen.
And I could almost guarantee you a year from now, if we're all gathered here, we will not be talking about Bernie Sanders as the candidate.
Who will we be? You think Kamala Harris, right?
I think it's going to come down to Kamala Harris and Elizabeth Warren, with potentially someone like Beto O'Rourke as a VP candidate.
Interesting.
So you don't think Elizabeth Warren's problems with who she is, in terms of
identity politics. I think they're going to be problematic. Potentially in the general election. I don't think there's going to be an issue at all in the primaries.
Yeah.
I don't think people really care about that.
I know
on the right people do care about it. And I can tell you on the left, people don't think of it. They think of it just like an attack, like a Pocahontas slur attack. Yeah. I don't think the general election, people care about jobs. People care about whether or not their children are going to go into, have a mortgage to go to school. Mm. I don't think people really care about things like, did she check something off on a form that she wasn't supposed to? I am surprised we aren't talking about Howard Schultz. He's the funnest candidate to talk about.
Don't the Democrats want someone that can win?
Absolutely, but everybody has a drawback, right? We've talked about Biden and his gaffes. Now
we haven't talked much about Amy Klobuchar. What is your assessment of Amy Klobuchar?
She's not going to get out of the primary. People already have serious issues with the way that she was managing her offices and the reputation that she had on the Hill, and that reputation preceded the article. So this has been going around in circles for a while, and I think people are looking for somebody, especially now when we're
and
talking.
And that's not just because she's a woman.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I mean, we're just talking about your managerial style. Everybody has one, and I think that hers, especially when we're talking about protecting employees, honoring people's, you know, dignity of work. We just spoke about it earlier. I think having somebody, and that those stories may just be the tip of the iceberg. I don't think people want to risk with any more stories coming out.
All right, I want to switch gears and talk about somebody, and then I want to get Kristen's response. Howard Schultz, mm-hmm. How important is he, or realistic is he, as a candidate for President of the United States as an independent?
Oh, he's tough because he's very, I like him. I think he's very attractive. I think he sort of fits into that centrist mold that a lot of people are looking for. Capitalist, yet compassionate, has a success story, will fight back when people have attacked him along those lines. But gosh, I mean, to get to a point where he is an actual player in a presidential race, I just feel like he's not prepared for what's coming his way. And so I don't see him really surviving. But I like the idea of trying to kind of break the mold of everything we're talking about here. You know, Democrat, Republican, who's going to appeal to black voters? What about a guy who just comes from the middle and sort of just speaks common sense? I think voters are looking for that.
And what about Beto O'Rourke? I mean, are you worried that Beto O'Rourke could be something like Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump combined, offered to the Democrats in 2020, that he's a guy that just catches fire because of his charisma? He may not have the track record. He may not have won an election. Obviously, he was a member of Congress. But again, he has the magnetic. He clicks with the crowd. He clicks with people, and they turn out in massive numbers to support him financially and at the polls.
I agree with all of that. I don't think he can beat Trump. And so at the end of the day, if someone like a Biden gets in, I still think that is the biggest, that is the thing that Republicans are most nervous about. And if it comes down to voters trying to decide who is best equipped to overturn and kick out an incumbent Republican Trump, I wouldn't see Beto O'Rourke being that person.
Georgia?
Yeah, I think that I'd like to see. I mean, he does very well on the campaign trail, but the question is, how does he actually manage a campaign?
Is he
smart? To manage
a
national campaign.
Is he smart?
I think he's intelligent. I think he's certainly more intelligent than the average member of Congress. But I think managing a national campaign, we talk a lot about the actual policies. It's a big job, and you can get caught up, and you know, it takes one little scandal or one little slip up, and all of a sudden you slip in the polls. I don't think he's ready for that type of spotlight yet. Going back to Schultz, I don't see him having a natural constituency. When you have when all the chips fall, who's his constituency that's going to turn out in the numbers needed to actually in a three-way field?
Schultz will have. Oh, go ahead.
My hope, because I'm afraid of the Democrats. With the social, I'm sorry, I still think they're going to try to do anything they can to make a world I don't want. It isn't that these people will leave the Democrats and vote for Trump. They will leave the Democrats and vote for him, vote for
but
Schultz.
I think there might be
just enough in the swing states that these people are the independents and so forth, that in some sense, even the fact that the DNC said they're not going to go on Fox for any of their primary debates. What a silly thing to do, to not at least show
Trump
your face to these people.
Trump boycotted the Fox debates as well.
Trump,
you don't remember?
I don't care what he did.
Trump boycotted, but what I'm saying is you didn't have an issue
just
with
think
it.
Of, I,
can I just get a word on Howard with. Schultz?
Sure.
So I have a message for Howard Schultz. We don't need any enlightened billionaires, you know, kind of jumping into the race to take us to the promised land. I think Howard Schultz will have a long conversation with the Starbucks board sometime between now and January. And he will not be running because I think you would see pretty quickly that stock begin to tank.
He avoided the question about whether or not he would sell his stock too. That
completely.
Was,
yeah. And I think he might even become a non-billionaire if he chooses to run. Because look, of all elections, my message to Howard Schultz is put your money behind the candidate that you think is most like you and, you know, most in line with your views. Because to, you know, the good professor's mm-hmm. point. It would be a boon to Donald Trump mm-hmm. to have a third-party mm-hmm. candidate, just like it was a boon to Donald Trump to have a couple of, you know, write-ins for Bernie Sanders and Jill Sanders. you know, in the last election.
Did you have the same feelings about J.B. Pritzker, another enlightened billionaire who just won the governor's office in Illinois?
But
I love the double standard.
No, there's no double standard. But
did you vote for
party
did
nomination.
You vote for Pritzker?
I did
support
but
him. Okay.
But the governor won the party nomination. If Howard Schultz wants to win a nomination, by all means, throw your hat
and
in the
really
Democratic
it was two
ring.
Billionaires on the ballot, right? So
yeah, it's exactly. It's like
well, right,
of,
and I don't
yeah.
have a problem with
we
that. I celebrate well.
Running for office.
I think success is a wonderful
yeah,
thing.
But no, going
you,
back with
like,
the natural constituency but in those swing states, right? You are right. He's going to peel off some voters, but he can't peel off enough voters to win the presidency. He knows that. Everybody knows that. So the only reason he's in is because of ego. And unfortunately, what we're seeing is he's detracting away from a real debate because he's not talking about the issues. When you hear Howard Schultz speak, he's not really talking about issues except in these like top lines that you see like in the top lines of a poll. He's not getting down into actual policy proposals. And so if the whole point is, well, I'm in as a spoiler to move the debate, you're not really advancing the debate by just talking about yourself.
But you just talked about earlier how you like to see enthusiastic primaries, and I get it, he's a third party, but why doesn't the more the merrier philosophy, everyone should run, nobody should run unopposed, people should run, but it doesn't apply to
I'm
him.
Happy to see him. No, I'm happy to see him run under the Democratic umbrella.
I've heard, I know nothing about it, and I don't
That's
drink.
That's the status quo. You're for the two parties.
I don't know. I mean, anyone.
You're speaking.
Hey, look, billionaires and non-billionaires alike. Bring them in. Put them in the. No, put them on the, up there and have them debate. I don't want
a lot
him.
Of snarky Mike. Things said about him. I never heard of him. I don't drink coffee, so I've never been to a Starbucks. I actually picked up some stuff for my son one time. I've been in one. I think maybe two at the most. So I looked him up. I talked to a friend, a colleague who's a professor of management. The guy came from nothing, right?
Yeah.
He came from from the projects, as they say. He came up with a really cool idea.
Mike, we've got to pause. We'll let you follow through on your bio on Howard Schultz. Bruce DuMont back in Chicago, and again, one of the other big stories that emerged last week was pushing North Korea back on the front burner. There were reports and intelligence surveillance video and pictures that were released, not by the government, but by a private source, and they basically showed that the North Koreans appear to have a variety of sites under construction or in varying degrees of construction. In North Korea, and some of these were being created during the time when Kim Jong-un and President Trump were meeting in Vietnam recently, and it's raised the issue of whether or not we're getting the straight poop from the President of the United States or from the intelligence community, and he was quizzed last week about what does this all mean given all the showmanship that you've put in to the two summits with your alleged buddy, Kim Jong-un. And this is what the president had to say.
Time will tell, but I have a feeling that our relationship with North Korea, Kim Jong-un and myself, Chairman Kim, I think it's a very good one. I think it remains good. I would be surprised in a negative way if he did anything that was not per our understanding.
Kristen, is this going to be a big Achilles heel for the president when 6 months ago we thought it was going to be a big opportunity for him?
I mean, we kind of know that the president doesn't have the best judgment when it comes to sidling up with foreign leaders where he thinks they're taking him seriously. He thinks they're negotiating in good faith. And these are just regimes that I personally, they won't ever negotiate in good faith. I mean, he was backing Syria's leader at one point. He's backed Putin. I'm just assuming this is going to be another case where it's going to be a hard lesson for him. At the same time, I don't think we should not be negotiating in some respects, but his ability to read the room is concerning.
Yeah, given the fact that we've also been talking about, you know, Paul Manafort and Michael Cohen, is he just a poor judge of character, Mike?
I wonder about how in the world he had Cohen for 10 years as his personal lawyer. But I see it. You never, ever negotiate without double-checking with a communist. Communists are notorious liars, and this is a communist nation. But if there is one positive thing about this, if this all blows up in his face, And we have to, and it gets into some kind of a conflict. He can say with a straight face, I did everything I could to try to meet this man halfway, and he would come nowhere. And I did more than anybody else to try to get this man to behave and to be part of the international community. And so if it does come to blows someday, I think we've at least set the stage that this isn't because of a lack of trying. It's because of the nature of the North Korean administration.
Would you give the president that credit, Peter?
No, I wouldn't. I think what Trump has done is he's skewed this traditional bottom-up diplomacy. And I mean, there's a reason why diplomacy is always kind of run from the ground up, because you allow the diplomats and the folks on the ground who can level with each other to knock out a lot of the things that you wouldn't want the two heads of state to be talking about. Trump's gone to Asia now twice, and we have virtually nothing to show for it except accelerated development on commercial satellite imagery. I can't even imagine what the intelligence community has of launch sites, nuclear refineries, nuclear fuel refineries.
We have captives returned. We have the returns of downed soldiers returned. And what we also don't have is we don't have the war games Kim Jong-un did not want.
And we canceled our own.
But the president argued that they were canceled because they were too costly.
I mean, it goes to the question and the issue, I think, that's been undertone here about the president's judgment. And I think his judgment isn't just bad with respect to sidling up to foreign leaders. I think his judgment is bad across the board. The professor mentioned, he's surprised that he ever hired someone like Michael Cohen. I mean, I'm an attorney. And I could tell you that an attorney like that, you hire only because you want someone who has no ethics, no sense of principle, and you want someone to do the dirty tricks that, only that type of person would do. So Donald Trump
including recording your client.
Including recording your clients. And Donald Trump, unfortunately for us and the country, and the world, really, is that type of person with that type of judgment.
Yeah. Georgia.
I mean, in North Korea, credit where credit is due. We did get the return of hostages. That's huge. The return of remains, that's huge. It's fantastic for their families. But by the same token, his policy on North Korea is so erratic. So on the one hand, people seem to forget that in the beginning of his presidency, he was threatening war with North Korea, remember?
Rocket Man.
Rocket Man. On Twitter.
Yeah, on Twitter. And we were, everyone was gripped with what's going to happen next. And then he reached out, and all of a sudden, as you said, they became kind of best friends. And the question is, if we ever do get to
maybe
that point,
that's
that
why
you're
they
saying
talked. Maybe because he said, we will not stand by and let you do this. Maybe that's why Kim came to the table.
Kim has always wanted to be at the table, though. Kim has asked every single administration. Kim's dream, that whole entire regime's dream, has been to get legitimacy from the United States government via a high-level meeting. That's what they've wanted. And that's what Trump gave them on a silver platter. That's absolutely a negative.
Barack Obama said he would talk to any leader at any time with no preconditions before he became president.
We should absolutely talk with governments, but at a certain level, and I think that's the point that you brought up, there's a diplomatic process that's involved because you don't want to give legitimacy. Because if we do ever get to that point that you're saying, God forbid, that there's a conflict, we've just legitimized our enemy and our adversary.
Right. No, we've done everything possible to try to stop it from occurring with a person who controls a huge military by impoverishing.
We gave him a chance.
The other point is that Donald Trump, in his heart, believes that his cult of personality, is going to be able to cut through and make any deal, whether it's a real estate deal in New York or whether it's dealing with Putin or Syria or anybody else.
But he did walk away.
There's a huge benefit to walking away, and the people that applauded him for walking away, were not necessarily the people that were closest to him.
One thing that I do want to point out, and I think this is a very serious issue for us to contemplate. You brought up the satellite imagery and what our clandestine services might know. One thing that we have to appreciate is how much Trump has disparaged our national intelligence community, and that if there was that case where he had to make the case for going into conflict to North Korea to protect the American people, would his base even believe him? Would they trust CIA images anymore or NSA intelligence when the president himself has undermined their legitimacy so much?
But Georgia, the left for the last 40 years has always questioned American intelligence.
Absolutely.
Whether it's the FBI, the CIA, you folks think that all your phone calls are listened in on and they've disrupted your political process for 40 years. I mean, of course, I think it's a logical thing for anyone to say, should an intelligence be analyzed? does everything the CIA say should it be believed? I don't think so.
But Bruce, there's a difference between being, skeptical or questioning programs that involve, LSD and kind of exotic, weird things and tracking, monitoring your own people and the Nixonian misuse of the FBI. There's a difference between that and then just at the most spatial top level saying, oh, I talked to this guy Putin and he said, we're good. I talked to this guy Kim Jong-un and he says, they're not building any nuclear sites. I believe that. While there's actual photographic evidence and kind of empirical.
But the question is, what would his intelligence supporters be saying? What would the leaders of the FBI be saying? The top five people of the FBI have either been fired or kicked off. What does it say about them? What does it say about James Clapper? What does it say about John Brennan? Yeah. James Clapper is a liar.
He lied
to Congress. He lied to the American people.
Yes, he
and
did.
He's now an analyst, on television. Where's the outrage for that? And by the way, that happened in response to a question from Ron Wyden, a great liberal from Oregon, who basically he lied to him when he said no, he did. There was no plan or no program going on where the United States government was listening in on phone conversations and intercepting phone lines. Mm-hmm. He lied or mail.
But I think that's a great. So what you're getting at is there's a difference between this deception of like covering up information versus what the atmosphere is now, which is I think if Trump came out and said, hey, the satellite imagery is fake news and manufactured, I think people would buy into it. And I think that's the difference, I think, in the
Bolton
debate.
Was on TV this morning. I happened to catch a little bit of the gas bag shows and and he made it perfectly clear that those were commercial satellites.
Yes.
And that the particular sites they were looking at have several operations. Mm-hmm. And it could be that this is simply a normal operation as opposed to one which is negative. They have a lot, and we look every day, apparently, with our much better satellites. And I assume that Bolton will be one who will be looking very carefully at these and giving the president good advice. Now, let's do remember that it was the left who told George Bush, you lied, people died. And what they lied about was what his intelligence told him. There were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. Every single intelligence agency said that was the case. The French said it, the British said it, the Germans said it, and you attacked him.
I think that story is a lot more
complicated.
What's complicated is that administration had an agenda to enter that war, and they actually sought the intelligence to corroborate
that. It's
okay
to attack. That's why we go down a rabbit hole, though.
One last thing. Backing up a little bit, the biggest problem to me about what Trump's doing is that he has so thoroughly degraded trust in public institutions that have predated him and will postdate him. And I mean, in my own life, I've interacted with people who just dismiss the FBI. Everything they do is just a lie to take down Trump, dismiss the CIA, dismiss all of these institutions that, in fact, have kept us safe for a very long time.
How do you defend the top five people of the FBI?
How do you possibly?
I mean, do you want to go through each one by one?
James Comey.
The question initially was, would the American people even trust some of this imagery because of the deep distrust that Trump has supposedly sowed? I think the American people still have trust in the rank and file of FBI, CIA. I think that the distrust is with the Washington, D.C. part of that, and it was, in my opinion, triggered in large part by Benghazi and having Susan Rice. I think that was the start of a modern day growing distrust with what the White House is talking to us about security and what's actually going on. And to your point, Susan Rice was then, obviously misled the American people on something very dramatic, serious, and emotional, and then was still permitted to be on television shows as an expert source, even though she had lied.
Right. When we come back, we'll talk more about Susan Rice. To phone calls we go. Let's go to Omar, listening to us on the internet tonight. You've got a question, Omar. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, hi.
Hi.
So I just was following some of the discussions here on the primaries and Bernie's electability.
Uh-huh.
And I just had a few things to say about that.
Sure.
So, I think the discussion here is happening in some kind of vacuum where you have, a normal president who doesn't do abnormal things. But on the other hand, what you really have is a 74-year-old man who only happens to be a few years younger than Bernie, who is not even coherent, whose mental stability has been questioned, who, according to White House sources, you know, which has been reported in the New York Times, watches 8 to 10 hours of television every day about himself, strolls into the White House at 11 a.m., and then pretends to do whatever it is that he's doing. But what we clearly know is that he's more interested in tweeting and creating chaos and insulting people than in actually governing. He's obviously a complete failure. So, you know, when you talk about, like, whether Bernie is electable or not based on his age or whether he will drive up the African-American vote, you know, the assumption is that you're running against a normal candidate, which you're clearly not. So, you know, I think we, in terms of whether it's about defeating him, it doesn't really matter who the candidate is. It's really about the issues. And what you have in the on the Republican side is a hardcore base of people who are very anti-immigrant, you know, and that's about 38 to 40% of the electorate.
Omar, there's also whether you describe them as anti-immigrant or not, which you just did, they also happen to disagree with something you just said, is that President Trump has had no successes. They think Donald Trump has had successes. Now, you don't agree with them on that, and so you dismiss them because you think they're wrong. But, you know, there's 62 million of them, and they like Donald Trump. The question is, are 62 million or more people going to come out again in 2020? That's the big question. And we're talking about the nuts and bolts of campaigns as well. How do you energize a campaign? Bernie Sanders knows how to energize a campaign. I mean, I'm not arguing, you know, against the age issue. I'm 74 myself, 74 as a kid. But
are you going to run?
No, I'm not going to run.
I'd vote for you, Bruce.
And I'm not going to even walk. I barely walk. But go ahead. Back to you, Omar.
Right. So I guess it depends on how you define his successes, right? So when it comes to the judges, there's very little that he has anything to do with that. That's really dependent on who's in control of the Senate.
He selects the members to be federal judges. The Senate votes on him. He selected the people to be on the Supreme Court, and then the Senate votes on him. So don't say that the president has no input into the judges. He has a great deal of input into judges, and a lot of people in the country who like him a lot, they like his selection of judges a lot.
I think what Omar is saying, though, is he's taken those names from a list that's provided to him. He's not actually...
He came up with the list.
No, he didn't come up with the list.
Nobody has said that.
Are we to avoid input from people who know a lot about judges?
Yeah, if they disagree with you.
I
think the point that the caller's trying to make is that when you have a Republican president, regardless of who that Republican president is, the list that they'll be picking from is the Federalist Society.
That's exactly
list.
Right.
But, but
in terms of electability, Bernie Sanders, socialist. Socialism, Venezuela. That's all it's going to take.
Or Sweden, or Denmark.
No, Sweden is not socialist.
Some of these
Sweden
other
is capitalist with a large
so
government.
So Bernie calls himself a democratic socialist, right?
There's a difference, especially
for example, when we talk about democratic socialism in Europe, we're actually talking more about center-left democratic policies here in the United States. So this goes back to our conversation
Sweden,
earlier about throwing
is, and
labels
Denmark
around. But
are
to go,
not
your caller brings
socialist.
Up a good point, though, on the age issue, and that's something Bernie should bring up on the campaign trail, where if people bring up the age, you know, the guy that's sitting in the White House is of a similar age, and so
age, but also I will say again, as someone who's 74, and he's not at 74, he has incredible energy.
Yes, he does,
and he doesn't need 8 hours of sleep every night. But go ahead, Bernie. Omar. Last word to you.
Well, so one thing that I wanted to say is, you know, in terms of his successes, you know, the judges issue, I think, you know, you can give credit to a president who's actually engaged in this process, but he is not engaged. He doesn't know anything, and he doesn't have any ideology. He doesn't really care. So you have Leo, you know, whatever his name is, from the Federalist Society, meeting with Don McGahn, and they've hashed out this list. And sure, okay, maybe you give him one thing, which is the judges, which is really by happenstance.
The
but
economy.
He's not achieved anything else, even the one thing on the
tax
that he promised. Mexico isn't paying for the wall.
That's true, but Omar, I'm going to give you one more example, and then we're going to move on to another caller. And that is one thing that the president did, based on advice he got from his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, is he pushed for in Congress, and he signed the most significant criminal justice reform legislation in the history of the country. It releases African Americans and minorities and everyone else that has been convicted, who fall through these guidelines, meet these guidelines. No Democrat did it. Now maybe Barack Obama started it. You're right. You make that point every week, Peter. But one guy signed it. One guy pushed it over the goal line, and literally tens of thousands of people who've spent their lives completely destroyed by the criminal justice system in the United States are either free now or on their way to freedom because of the First Step Act signed by Donald Trump. No Democrat did it. That's something else that's positive in addition to some of the others. We've got to say farewell to you. Our thanks to all of our guests this evening, Kristen McQuarrie of the Tribune, Mike Miller of DePaul University, Peter Hanna from Kent, Chicago Kent, and Georgia Logothetes from The Cost. I'm Bruce Dumont. Good night from Chicago. Back in Chicago, thanks very much for joining us this evening. We've got a great panel, and we're going to let them introduce themselves right now, starting with Georgia Logothetes.
Hi, I'm Georgia Logotheti. I am a contributing editor at Daily Kos. I'm also a former attorney.
And you're a mother of two.
Mother of two, yeah.
Ooh,
brand new number two.
When you first did the show, you were single.
I was single, yeah. It's been a while. Can you tell all the gray hair?
No, you're actually the second.
And the under-eye circles from lack of sleep. You know,
We had a guest a couple of weeks ago, Dan Johnson, and he started on this show when he was single, and now he has four children.
This is a breeding ground. I'm good with two for now. Thanks, Bruce.
Mike Miller.
Hi, I'm a applied macroeconomist at DePaul. I've been there since 1980, and I do a little bit of research on the side on the economy of Bahrain in the Middle East.
And what do you, when you go there, what are you looking for?
How the economy operates. It's very small compared to the U.S., so how does a small economy operate compared to a big one? And it's very interesting. We have an MBA there, so I get to teach once every year or two, and it's a great experience. I've spent about a total of 9 months there over the years and have great appreciation for it. It's essentially a Muslim Arab culture, and it's just fabulous to be there.
How many U.S. troops are there? That's one of the
main. That's the Fifth Fleet is there, and I've had former students who were military, mm-hmm. and several students who were civilian employees of the Fifth Fleet.
Peter Hanna.
My name is Peter Hanna. I'm an attorney and have a significant amount of constitutional law, civil rights, civil liberties experience. I work with nonprofits and lawmakers on a number of issues, particularly in the technology, the area of technology, cybersecurity, privacy, data protection. I'm also an adjunct professor of law at Chicago Kent, where I teach privacy.
And how old were you when you came to the United States?
Two. Christmas Day, 1982.
Cool. And what is your first memory as an American?
My first memory as an American was actually probably the first toy I received when I must have been maybe like five or something.
And it was made in Japan.
No, it was actually an Apollo 11 lunar module lander, because actually Apollo 11, that mission and the entire Apollo Mercury mission were the things that kind of first sparked my father's interest in moving to a country where, you know, anything is possible. Yeah. So
a broader question, getting back to the first, you came to this country, you've become a citizen since you've arrived here. Is Egypt and the future of Egypt, is it Is it top of your mind? Is it midway through your, how much, I don't want to say allegiance, but how much interest do you have in the future of your original country?
It's a good, really good question. I always joke to my friends that Egypt is a country peaked too early. You know, those pyramids were really pretty great 5,000 years ago. So, you know, hit its prime way, way too early. You know, I think the people of Egypt, like frankly, the people of most nations are, you know, good people. They want what everyone wants, which is safety and happiness. When I think about Egypt, I look at the last like 5 or 6 years and see the Arab Spring to the election of, you know, Muslim Brotherhood president to the deposing of that person and replacement by someone who looks and acts very similarly to, you know, the previous president, Hosni Mubarak. I think that it's just, you know, like the building of the pyramids, you know, getting to the right place will take a very long time. And I hope Egypt reaches that place, and I hope I get a chance to enjoy it. And I hope everyone gets a chance to visit Egypt, because it's a remarkable place.
Kristen McQuarrie.
I'm Kristen McQuarrie. I'm a member of the Tribune, Chicago Tribune editorial board, and I have a column that runs on Tuesdays. I've always worked at newspapers. I tend to have a more conservative-leaning approach to problems in Chicago and Illinois, which makes me a very, very lonely person in a very blue, growing Democratic state and city.
What about an editorial board? When you have your editorial, do they listen respectfully, or are they... you know, are they clipping their nails while you're making your pitch?
Clipping nails. They are, my voice is like hands on a chalkboard, okay. I'm sure to them.
Bruce Dole allows a free flow.
Oh, sure.
He's the
I mean,
editor of the Tribune, a good longtime
yes.
friend.
The Chicago Tribune editorial page, separate from the newsroom, has a history of being more conservative leaning, free markets. Milton Friedman is our North Star. So I'm fortunate in that. My own personal views kind of match up with the views of the Tribune most of the time. And yes, our editorial board is very diverse, from pretty left-leaning to libertarian to moderately conservative to conservative. So
when you have a discussion, I mean, are there votes? I mean, it literally does an endorsement of someone, does it win with a 5-4 vote? Or, I mean, how does that happen once you're making a major decision in a political race?
Well, endorsements are different than the day-to-day decisions that we make on what to write about and who writes those. We sort of have beats, almost like you do in the newsroom. But an endorsement is generally, I mean, yes, they can be really down and dirty debates. They can get pretty boisterous. But the ultimate decision is the editorial page editor and the publisher. So I don't always agree with who we endorse in major races. And neither do other members of the board.
Question back to you, Georgia, and that is, I want to come back to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, mm-hmm. who has become this media darling. She's an important political figure. Is she more of an important political figure, or is she more important as a media figure? And by being a media figure, she attracts attention and then is able to spread her thoughts and opinions to a broader group on Twitter and Facebook and every place else.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, she's still a freshman member of Congress, right? And how much
yes.
power do those people wield? So I do think it is more of a media star that she is right now. Policy-wise, if she, you know, she introduced a bill, but she had to partner up with somebody else on it. I do think that she brings a lot to the table. I think, like I mentioned earlier on the show, she brings a certain energy. And because there is this fascination with her and how her star has risen, anything that she says automatically gets attention. It's a good thing and a bad thing, right? It's good when she's talking about something that I agree with. It's bad when she's talking about something I'm not agreeing with. But I am happy that there is this new life in the Democratic Party, because for far too long, just like on the right, we were the party of old white men. And I think that now we're seeing a little bit of a change. Although if you look at the latest Iowa poll, it looks like we still may be the party of old white men, but we'll see.
To what extent is she an important figure because of her attractiveness?
I think that certainly adds to kind of the star status of it. I think, you know, it's something that is good for Instagram. It's something that's good for live video. People like to retweet her. But at the end of the day, what she's saying holds far more weight, I think, than how she looks in a photo. And what she's saying is resonating with a new generation of people who feel like their voice has been ignored for far too long.
Is she creating or continuing to expand the base of Bernie Sanders, Peter, in your opinion? I mean, clearly, she is saying a lot of things that Bernie has said before, and she seems to be, not that he doesn't have energy, but she seems to be another element of energy from the left in the party, as well as Bernie Sanders.
Yeah, I think so. And I think the, you know, a lot of the ideas that she's putting forward, although, again, she is a freshman congresswoman, so politically, you know, limited power. But I think she's using her platform to amplify a lot of the ideas that galvanized the base that really supported Bernie Sanders in the, you know, the previous primary in the election. And I think she's going to continue to do that. I think it's great for the Democratic Party. I think it's great for democracy to have these different voices and have people who, you know, maybe are even more relatable than, I mean, certainly infinitely more relatable than someone like Mitch McConnell, out there speaking to the issues that really affect people day in and day out. So I think it's a very good thing, and I think she's a, you know, a great, great person to amplify those issues.
Kristen, how important is, first of all, do you agree that, she's maybe more a media darling than a political darling, or is it a combination of both?
No, I think she's more of a media darling right now by a media that's pretty hypocritical in the way they cover her and the mistakes that she makes and the historical references she makes that are factually incorrect. I mean, just the other day, I think she referred to Ronald Reagan as a racist. I mean, I think the only kind of kind thing I can say about her is that it's refreshing to see someone go to Washington and question things like lobbyist relationships and why are all these people lining up for committee hearings? Oh, they're homeless people who get paid to stand in line for the lobbyists. I just think it's going to be a very tough landing for her when she figures out that you if you want to stay in Washington, you can't be so outside of the game that you don't recognize your own party, your establishment Democratic Party, is also taking lots of money from lobbyists and doing all the things that she finds despicable. And I think she just hired her boyfriend to be on staff. So I think when you have that meteoric of a rise, you're going to have a pretty steep fall at some point.
In addition to her, you have the representative from Michigan. You also have the representative from Minnesota that we talked about earlier, Representative Omar. Do you expect all of them to be primaried, Georgia? I mean, will these upstarts be challenged?
I hope so, because I'm for primaries in general. I think nobody should ever run for office unopposed. I think in a healthy democracy, you have people that step up to the plate. Now, I don't know if as many as we saw in the mayoral election, I feel like that may have been a little bit too much, but it's nice to have a healthy debate, and it forces members of Congress to defend their records, whether you're a freshman that just stepped off of, you know, 2 years of your job, or whether you've been there for two decades. You should be held accountable for your record when you go back to voters.
Is it, this past week, Hillary Clinton said she was not going to run. Michael Bloomberg said he's not going to run. Sherrod Brown said that he's not going to run. Of those three, who was the most important one that you didn't want to hear say they were not going to run?
Brown. I think that he had just completed a Dignity of Work tour. Yeah. And I think that his voice was one that was really needed to talk about what people are going through on a day-to-day basis, the people that are putting in 12-hour work days. That became the sole drum that he was beating. Mm. And I'm hoping that somebody else picks that up in the primaries.
Interesting he picked that up. It seems like the Democrats kind of ignored that whole entire group of people during the last election. And that's why they lost Michigan and
Ohio,
Wisconsin, and Ohio, and Pennsylvania, and Florida.
When we come back, I want to talk about who wins those states the next time around. And I want to look at the field. Iowa has come out with its first straw poll. And they've got Joe Biden in first place and Bernie Sanders in second place. We'll talk about that and the rest of that field, which are pretty much also Rens, when we come back from Chicago. Bruce DuMont back in Chicago, and again, I want to give a great big welcome to new listeners in St. Louis, Missouri, joining us tonight on KXFN, 1380 AM, 105.3 FM, The Answer. It's a Salem station. It's our third Salem station joining us on the air, and again, it's great to be on now in St. Louis, and to everybody listening in St. Louis for the very first time to this program, I am not a Cubs fan. period. I am not a Cubs fan. I'm a White Sox fan. So anyway, because I know that if you live in St. Louis, that's one of the first questions people ask is your baseball fandom. And again, certainly the rivalry between Chicago and St. Louis, at least on the baseball field, has been pretty dramatic. But again, it's great to have you with us, part of the Beyond the Beltway Network, every Sunday night. Nice to have you with us. Let's talk about this Iowa poll that came out. It had Joe Biden in first place with 27%. These are of Democratic voters in Iowa, caucus participants. Bernie Sanders was second with 25%. Then Elizabeth Warren with 9%. And then 8% for Kamala Harris. And then 5% for Beto O'Rourke. And everybody else was basically 3% or 1%. But there were 13% that were undecided. So my question to you is, how strong a candidate is Joe Biden, in your opinion? Peter, I want to get it from you first.
I think Joe Biden, like many other candidates, missed their moment in the last election. I think they could have been very formidable opponents and formidable candidates. Had that primary been as broad and open as the primary we have coming up in 2020, I think he would still be a really strong candidate, and I think he could, defeat Donald Trump in a presidential election. But I think these polls are super duper early. It's a very long campaign season. And I think right now it's really just name recognition more than anything else.
Georgia.
I think people underestimate Joe Biden. I think they kind of cast him aside as well. You know, people want a young woman to be on the ticket. I think they underestimate the appeal that he has based off of his decades of relationship building across the country with state and local Democratic parties. So that's the first thing. Second of all, he's absolutely right. It is so early. A lot of it obviously is name recognition. You can see that by the fact that a member in Texas who, you know, is all of a sudden ranking in the top 10 and
loser.
Yeah, a loser in Texas. So I think one thing though to pay attention to is the fact though it's early, but it's not so early that those candidates that are below the top five shouldn't start wondering a little bit about maybe altering their strategy or a massive infusion of money to get some more attention.
I agree with Peter. I think Joe Biden is a guy whose time has passed. I mean, his time has passed. Historically, when he ran for president on his own, he ran two very lousy campaigns for president, had to literally drop out, forced out of one because of the plagiarism charge, wasn't very successful in the other one when he ran against Barack Obama. I think was surprised that he was picked by Barack Obama, at least it surprised a lot of political stuff. And I just think there's a vault full of videotape of Joe Biden saying things and doing things, whether it's his conduct of the Anita Hill Clarence Thomas hearings or other statements or you know, hugging women or whatever the case may be. I think there's a whole bunch of stuff in his background that will come out, and his best day as a candidate is the day before he announces.
I think that's the problem with a lot of the candidates. They haven't really been vetted, right? I mean, even look at Bernie Sanders.
Right.
One of the complaints that a lot of people in the Clinton camp have is that she kind of held her fire and didn't go after him, in part because she didn't want to have such a fractured post-primary base, which she ended up having anyway. So a lot of these candidates, it's their first time in the national spotlight, and they want the presidency pretty bad. So I think you'll be surprised what comes out.
I don't know. I see him as the person that would make Trump supporters most nervous because even though he has, there is this vault of gaffes. I mean, you can look up all the gaffes of Joe Biden. He always gets a pass. I mean, this is someone who said you can't walk into a 7-Eleven without an Indian accent. That's just the beginning of a long list of things that if anyone else uttered those remarks, they would be forced to step down.
And Barack Obama was clean and articulate.
Yes, good looking. Clean and here we've got this black candidate who's I mean,
you may say the same thing about Kamala Harris.
She would crush him if he did. But the point is, he has so he gets away with those kinds of things. People just like, oh, he's just bumbling Joe, but he is very likable and he's really smart. I mean, if you think back to his debate with Paul Ryan and how he just cleaned the floor with Paul Ryan. I think sometimes people underestimate his vast ability to, if he focuses, to really impress people. And I think he has a young audience that really kind of likes that authentic
the
Joe.
The Uncle Joe thing. Yes. Yeah. And I think actually something that's been floated is him
running and picking up Harris as a VP and then pledging to only run one term. I think a lot of those gaffes and those kind of grievances would be forgiven if people knew that essentially they had Harris in the waiting.
But you're correct about stuff coming out. I think I just saw this week, maybe in the Tribune, about comments he made in the 70s regarding busing in Delaware. And, it takes you have to sit next to a white child for a black child to learn or something. Oh, my gosh. I'm not sure we have the complete context, but if you were to read the sentences he said, they would be devastating.
Like, and this may be a question for you from the newspaper side, but aren't we living in kind of a post-accountability world right now where if you do end up saying something because of the news cycle and because of how people just give everything a pass at the end of the day and just vote D or R, I think that a lot of the stuff that may be coming out at the end of the day, people just want Trump out of office, that they're willing to forgive a lot of stuff. And the opposite way, too, people are willing to forgive a lot of stuff from Trump as well to vote for him.
Yes, I think that's true. But I think if you compile all of this stuff about Joe Biden, it could be enough to dismantle him because you don't want to have Trump part two in who can't control what he says. I think people like him and he gets a pass.
He's a
who? I think he gets a pass in the general election. I don't think he gets a pass in the primary. The primary is what could kill him off because too many other people saying, why him? Why him? And again, you've got Bernie Sanders out there. He's still playing to big crowds and raising lots of money. I'm Bruce DuMont. We've got another full hour wherever you're listening from coast to coast and border to border. Don't go away. We will return from Chicago with another full hour of Beyond the Beltway.